I'm here representing the Bradenton branch of the American Association of University Women, and we're partnering with this Commission for the Status of Women to celebrate women's equity. It has been 99 years since women have had the right to vote, and we are really celebrating all the changes that have happened for women. AAUW is all about equity for women and girls, and we're proud of the advancements that have been made. But we know we have a ways to go. We're promoting pay equity, equal rights, and definitely women's voice in the community. It's such a partnership across the entire community of Sarasota Manatee to really support women as we work for all young women. We are very pleased that the USF branch of AAUW is here. So we not only are celebrating women of our age, but also women that are the future leaders of our country. The Bradenton branch of the American Association of University Women has some key projects that we really thrive on. One of them is promoting science, technology, engineering, and mathematics for young women. We call that Tech Savvy. And we have a conference every year for middle school girls to promote that. We also recognize women of achievement who have done wonderful advances in the community. We also provide scholarships to women returning to further their education from the workforce. So we have a lot to be proud of, and our goal is to celebrate equity in everything that we do.
For women to band together. One of the reasons I started my organization, SWAT Networking, it's really important that women band together. And this particular luncheon combines women of all different nationalities and feelings and beliefs and religions, and everybody comes together to support women's right to vote. And it's just really important for us to be here and band together. I think it just says that we all believe the same thing, the importance of women's right to vote and women networking and women supporting women and empowering women. And you can see by how many people are here and feel the energy of how everyone feels the same way. I think it's the same message that we've been trying to get across for many, many years to young people, why they need to vote. And so many people say, oh, it's just me. If I don't vote, what's the big deal? But when you put everyone who has that belief system together, then nobody votes. And then they complain about who's in office and not getting their message across. So it's not only important for young women to vote, it's important for everyone to vote.
It's very important because the league itself was formed as an outcome of the effort to have women get the right to vote. And it was formed by the same women who took part in that struggle, which everyone knows was very difficult and went on for many years. So yes, we celebrate our right to vote and the birth of our league every year. It's wonderful. It's good to see that so many people are engaged in government and interested in all the issues. These are active citizens here today, the people who care enough to make the effort to go out and try to engage the community into being more active. And all of the programs and organizations that are affiliated and working together, it's really a wonderful thing. Well, these are some of the things we do, and one of them is to conduct voter registration drives. Another is to hold educational topics on current issues, and what we will do usually is have pro and con speakers. And we also put out our voter's guides, which we put together by means of a questionnaire that we send to all the candidates, and they respond, and we put them together, and we have our guides that we distribute, and we put it on our website. Well, I would like to say that I think young people are becoming more involved. They're suddenly seeing that they have a very large stake and being active in government and helping to make those decisions at the polls. We have had a lot more response to our voter registration drives held at the high schools and the colleges. And I would say to them that this is of great importance to you. You need to become involved and be a fully functional citizen.
To speak today, and I think it's important to be here because, you know, this is a day where we're celebrating where women actually got the right to vote, and which led all the way up to now women are police officers and lawyers and judges and doctors and can be anything that they want to be. So I think it's really important that we celebrate this day so that children, girls, boys, women, men, everyone understands the importance of equality. Well, it doesn't surprise me. Sarasota has a strong contingency of women that are doing great things in our community, and it's wonderful to see all of these very strong, intelligent, beautiful women coming together to celebrate almost 100 years of actually getting the right to vote. Well, there were a lot of challenges throughout my career, and I was very fortunate that I have a dad that was in law enforcement and a grandfather, and now I have a daughter that's in law enforcement, so we have a long legacy. But there were challenges along the way, and I've grown from them and learn from them, and hopefully I can share some of those experiences to other women and even other police officers to help them overcome any problems that they face in their career. Well, it's so important for everyone to get out and vote. Every vote counts. That's what happens in our great country in the United States, is you have the right and the power through your vote to voice your opinion about who you think should represent you. So when we don't vote, we are actually giving away something that people across the world wish they had the opportunity to have a say in their government, a say in who rules them, and I think that's so vital and important. So I really encourage everyone to get out and vote, have a voice, so you get your opinions and your thoughts and make our country the way that you want it to be, a free society where we have the right to have our voice.
Um, My name's Gabrielle Stafford. I've been a Girl Scout for 8 years, and I go to SCS Middle School.
My name is Janine Castro. I am in 10th grade, and I go to Sarasota High School. I like to be involved in Girl Scouts because I have learned valuable lessons. I have gone to Baltimore, Maryland, and done an urban backpacking trip, which I would have never had the opportunity to do before if I was not in Girl Scouts.
I really love the relationship I've had with the people that are in my troop. I know I have some lifelong friends in there, and it's just been a great opportunity to just go on field trips and do community service and just having fun with them. It's just been the best experience. We've done beach cleanups. We've helped set up different ceremonies and things like that. And we've helped represent Girl Scouts in some different places like this event here. And as a troop, we've just had a great experience going to schools and things like that.
And I went to Baltimore, Maryland on an urban backpacking trip. And that was a community service-based trip. So the very first day, we went to the zoo and we did community service there. We planted trees. We did all their like different beautification projects that they had. And we went to Darley Park, which is a less fortunate park in the Baltimore area. We helped create a better lifestyle for them. We had mowed the lawn, we planted new plants, we cleaned up the trash, and we even met some people from the community and got to talk to them about their inputs and what they would like to see happen in their community.
I would say it's great to be in Girl Scouts because it's great for your college applications, and it'll look good on schools, and you'll have a lot of friends that'll help you get through hard stuff, and they'll never turn your back on you, and it's just a great experience just to be. It's like a whole family when you're in Girl Scouts, and it's nice to see people have smiles on their faces when we help them.
I tell my friends all the time, I'm like, hey, it's not just a place where you have to do work. You get to interact with people. You get to find people with your own communities. Find people who can help you with projects. Make lifelong friends. It's not just learning the whole time. It's also you get to interact with people in the community.
It's great to see like the people that come to our desk and to our area. Like they say I've been a Girl Scout too, and it's great to see like the whole bunch of generations they've had from, and like the differences between their generation to our generation. They're telling us their experiences, and it's great to hear their opinions on things. And it's great to just see all these people celebrating the 19th Amendment.
This is an amazing event. I started coming to it maybe 5 or 6 years ago, and it really makes you proud to appreciate what's gone on with women and women's involvement in the community and politics.
This is my 19th year attending. I'm Ginny Hyman. I'm the chair of the Suncoast Commission on the Status of Women, and I've been attending for 19 years now, and we are one of the sponsors of this event. It started out with the Sarasota and the Manatee Commissions organizing and having the events, and it expanded to have the League of Women Voters and AAOW help us because it became so large. This is for Women's Equity Day, and there's a difference between Women's Equity Day and Women's Equality Day. The difference is the substance of the day, and that's what we're commemorating today.
It's wonderful to see so many women here from all walks of life, so many younger women. People don't realize how important this program is until they've come. I've brought all kinds of people here, and everyone has said, I had no idea about any of this. So,
well, they're going to have a really good idea in 2 years, because in 2020, we are partnering with the National Association of Commissions for Women and the Florida Commission for Women Foundation, and we will be having a symposium at one of the local hotels and have national speakers as well as local speakers to commemorate the 100 years that women have had the right to vote. I would tell young people, particularly the 18 to 50-year-old group, that your voice matters and your vote matters. And when women vote, women win. We've expanded our commission this year to include not only Sarasota, but Manatee, Pinellas, Pasco, and Charlotte counties, so that we now are representing 500,000 women, and we will be doing a survey through SurveyMonkey called Your Voice Matters. If you'd like to be part of the survey, come to our Facebook page for the Suncoast Commission on the Status of Women and just leave us your email and we'll make sure you get the survey.
You don't count if you don't vote. You don't count if you don't participate, and this is a great way to get an introduction to what it means to women to have the right to vote and to become an equal footing with in the community.
Charles, you remember when we started in 1995? What a crowd it is. What a positive impact it has made. That over the years, both in Manatee and Sarasota, we have celebrated it. And people have come from all over Florida. And your MET has been involved also. So it gives me a great pleasure, not pleasure, but humbled also, to see so many women as well as men working together to believe in what we believe in. To look at everybody, the room filled up, the people here, all with positive, same energy, same thing on their mind. I mean, it makes me so proud. It makes me so good that where we started at in the exhibition hall, downtown Bradenton, and see today we have been all over, and we are not going to stop here because we are planning on 2,200 years, and that's going to be our big celebration here, and we will involve the not only the Florida Commission on the Status of Women, but National Commission and all others, and you and I are going to work together on it.
Welcome to the annual Women's Equity Day Luncheon celebrating passage of the 19th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States, giving women the right to vote. Let us begin with the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. If you will please stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Thank you very much. We are very pleased that this is a sold out, more than sold out luncheon. And we could not have done this, accomplished this important community event without the help of many people. First, our sponsors who support the event financially or with publicity, and they are West Coast Woman, Manatee Educational TV, New College of Florida, Hope Family Services, Manatee Memorial Hospital, the Women's Resource Center for Manatee and Sarasota, and Doctors Hospital. You will find all their logos on page 6 in your program. And on page 8, you will find the members of our host committee, as well as the planning committee for this event. You'll also find in your program letters of support from the state presidents of AAUW, the League of Women Voters, as well as the Florida Commission on the Status of Women, and the governor. I would now like to introduce those at the head table and other honored guests here today. On my far left is Carol Hartz, who is president of the Sarasota League of Women Voters. Next is our speaker, Chief Bernadette DePino, City of Sarasota Chief of Police. Our honorary chair, Judge Susan Malucci, Circuit Court Judge in the 12th District. And I'm Carol Noonan, and that is not a typographical error in your program. It's Noonan, not Newman. And in attendance today are office holders, former office holders, and a number of candidates. I would like to go through the list, and I would like you to hold your applause until the end, if you can bear it. These are more or less in alphabetical order. Current and former office holders. The Honorable Jennifer Ahern Koch, Vice Mayor of the City of Sarasota. The Honorable Liz Alpert, Commissioner, City of Sarasota. The Honorable Suzanne Atwell, former Mayor and Commissioner for the City of Sarasota. The Honorable Shirley Brown, Sarasota County School Board and candidate for school board. The Honorable David Miner, member of the Manatee County School Board. The Honorable Mary Ann Servian, former Mayor and City Commissioner in Sarasota. The Honorable Willie Shaw, Commissioner, City of Sarasota. The Honorable Caroline Zucker, Sarasota County School Board. And candidates for office, Alexandra Coe, Republican candidate for Sarasota Board of County Commissioners. Liv Coleman, Democratic candidate for State House District 73. James Golden, Manatee School Board candidate. Nick Guy, candidate for Sarasota County School Board. Ruta Giuniari, Democratic candidate for the Sarasota Board of County Commissioners. Tracy Pratt, Democratic candidate for State House District 71. Maria Rule, candidate for Circuit Judge, 12th Judicial Circuit. Jan Schneider, Democratic candidate for Representative to Congress, District 16. David Shapiro, Democratic candidate for Representative to Congress, District 16. Joe Stokes, candidate for Manatee County School Board. And now, a round of applause for all of these. If I've forgotten anybody or missed anybody, because we had some last minute arrivals, please bring them to my attention. I'm sitting right over here, and I'll announce them after lunch. The film that was playing as we assembled is entitled Equality, I Am Woman, depicting a march in New York City in 1970, marking the 50th anniversary of passage of the 19th Amendment. That march resulted in a resolution introduced by Bella Abzug and passed by Congress, setting August 26th as Women's Equality Day. Thus, the reason we celebrate every year on or about August 26th. We're going to run it again as you begin to enjoy your lunch. Thank you.
I'll just tell you my memories. All I can tell you is that all day long I was busy doing events around the city. Not only did we visit the mayor with Betty Friedan to talk about things, we went to a fancy bar downtown where women weren't allowed to eat lunch, and of course everybody knew it was our day. And we did a statue action in Times Square where we had a mass for the repose of the soul of male supremacy. We had a woman dressed as a priest, and I recited the prayer, Our Mother who art in heaven, sister, we call thy name. Our kitchen's done, our nursery's run, on earth and it isn't heaven. Give us the right to earn our bread.
I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore. And I know too much to go back and pretend. 'Cause I've heard it all before, and I've been down there on the floor. No one's ever gonna keep me down again. Whoa, yes, I'm wise, but it's wisdom for the pain. Yes, I paid the price, but look how much I gained.
Turned the corner at 57th Street, 5th Avenue, I couldn't believe what I saw. Thousands and thousands of women lined up. You couldn't see the end of the line. They started at 57th and 5th Avenue, and it went all way past the library. And people were just milling around, and the cars were honking on the side because the mayor had given us only half the street. So the word was, by the young woman who was in charge of this, who planned the whole statue action, when the whistle blows, run in front of the Socialist Workers Party women and take the whole avenue.
On behalf of the unprecedented coalition of women that today has called this strike to confront the unfinished business of our equality, women young and old, women black and white, women students, women grandmothers who fought for the original right to vote, women Republicans, Democrats, Socialists, young radical women, establishment women, rich women who know that all women are poor, housewives, professional women, women who are famous, but no woman makes it alone, and that's all women are equal and free.
We wanted to show that women's full participation would also reduce the cult of masculinity that had led to the Vietnam War. It was the first time that I, and I think many of us, had actually marched for women. We'd marched against the war, we'd marched for civil rights, which obviously include women, but for women of all races together, this was the first big march. And it changed our consciousness, it changed our lives.
'cause it only serves to make me more determined to achieve my final goal. And I come back even stronger, not a novice any longer, 'cause you've deepened the conviction in my soul. Oh yes, I'm wise, but it's wisdom born of pain. Yes, I paid the price, but look how much I gained. If I have to, I can do anything. I am strong,
strong.
I am invincible,
It was like the most joyous, unbelievable walk and dance and singing and screaming, and women were pushing buggies with children and men were there. And as we would go down the avenue, we would yell, "Join us," because there were thousands of people on the side looking. And so many joined us, not only women, but men did. And we realized at that time that we were no longer a few kooky women that they made fun of, but we were a movement. And you cannot just plan a movement. It happens. It happens.
I am woman. Watch me grow. See me standing toe to toe as I spread my loving arms across the land. But I'm still an embryo with a long I gain if I
of the people I missed when I made the announcements earlier. First of all, from my own hometown, Mitzi Fiedler, Venice City Council. Also, Debbie Trice, a former member of the Charter Review Board of Sarasota County, and Krista Lohr, candidate for the Charter Review Board in Sarasota County. They all got their own rounds of applause. And for another round for all of our office holders, candidates, and former office holders. And now it is my pleasure to introduce our honorary chair. After receiving her law degree from the University of Florida, she served in private practice and as a prosecutor in the 12th Circuit. She's been a member of the Florida Association of Women Lawyers for more than 30 years and currently serves on their board. After almost a decade overseeing family cases as a magistrate, in 2014, she was elected as circuit judge in the 12th Judicial Circuit, presiding in Manatee County, currently in family court. You will find her biography on page 5 of your program, so I will not give you any more of the details of her qualifications and activities, but it gives me great pleasure to present our honorary chair, Judge Susan Malucci.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It is my great honor to present to you some highlights of the woman who leads the Sarasota Police Department, including her 6 years as chief of the Sarasota Police Department and the first chief, woman chief of the Sarasota Police Department. Chief Bernadette DePino has been in law enforcement for more than 30 years. She was recognized for the first time as Officer of the Year after just 2 years on the force, and she would receive that award twice more over the next decade. Chief DePino is an FBI National Academy graduate. Chief DePino has held many positions in law enforcement. A detective, a member of the SWAT team, an appointee by the governor of Maryland to the Maryland Police Training Commission. She's a member of the executive committee of the State Association of Chiefs of Police. She came to Sarasota as a veteran chief of police from Ocean City, Maryland. Chief DePino arrived here with a vision of smarter policing. After her appointment as chief, on December 31st of 2012, Chief DePino started by creating relationships within the community, developing a system of greater transparency at the Sarasota Police Department, using community policing and community engagement as tools to establish trust. Some examples of the work that she's done there: the Citizens Police Academy for adults, and for young people, the Shop with a Cop and movie night on the grounds of the Sarasota Police Department geared toward families with children. Her administration is responsible for hiring the majority of the officers currently on the force, always working to increase diversity within the department. Under Chief DePino's leadership, Sarasota Police Department has grown and developed. She has worked to change the culture. She has become not only a leader within law enforcement, but also a leader within our community. To the host committee and guests of the 24th annual Women's Equity Luncheon, I present to you Sarasota Police Chief Bernadette DePino.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and I am so honored to be here speaking to this room full of distinguished women and men, and to help celebrate the 98th year where women were allowed to vote. I give yourselves a round of applause. know, one of the first things I want to start off with my talk today is like the difference between male and female police chiefs, because there is differences, just in case you didn't think there was. The first thing that is different is that I've never to this date ever seen a male police officer with a better designer purse than me, okay? The next thing is that the difference is the bathrooms, and I find it's so much easier being a female police chief because when I go to functions, all the men are waiting in the long lines, and I just go in and there's hardly anybody in the other rooms. And then the last thing is appearance. Of course, we look different, and I have to tell you, the first time someone brought to my attention, it's happened many times in my career as a police chief, is that they say to me when they meet me, "Oh, you're a police chief? You don't look like a police chief." And the first time I was quite offended and taken aback, and I was like, well, what do you mean by that? I'm the police chief. Why? What do you mean I don't look like the police chief? I'm like, you know, police chief to us is like Carol O'Connor in the Heat of the Night, a fat, bald-headed guy. And I'm like, thank you for not thinking that I look like a police chief. I never want to look like that ever again. So, I'm honored to be here to speak to you today to talk about a little bit about my career and some of the challenges I faced in my career, and maybe for you to get to know me a little bit better, because I think that's really important in law enforcement, is for you to know the people that are in your community protecting you, serving you every single day. But before I start talking about myself, I thought, wow, 98 years. What happened about 100 years ago? What's different now between, you know, that time and now? And so I looked up some facts, and I found it kind of interesting. I thought you might find it interesting, too. Like, the tallest building in the world 100 years ago was the Eiffel Tower, okay? So I was like, wow. And I love Paris anyway, so I was like, that's interesting. And more people died from the flu 100 years ago. Actually, 50 million people in 1918 died from the flu, then 16 million that died during all of World War I. So the flu, now luckily they came up with vaccines in like 1945, but I just thought that was interesting, especially because I knew my great-grandfather died from the flu in that year. Bread was 10 cents, so that was pretty cheap. I thought that was good. But the salaries were about $1,500 a year, so now you can see why bread still wasn't that cheap even then. The hot actor of the time was Charlie Chaplin, okay, as opposed to like George Clooney or somebody like that. Tastes are different a little bit. The time zones were created. I was like, wow, that's really interesting. That's because the transportation across the country, they had to develop time zones. So I thought, okay, that's cool. But things are still kind of the same because everybody, you all have to shop on Amazon, right? Everybody shops on Amazon. Well, they were doing Amazon back then. Actually, though, you could buy a house by catalog. I thought that was really interesting. You could order an entire house through a catalog. So I think, okay, the people were pretty modern back then. And then I did a little research about women police officers, and when do women officially become police officers in the United States of America? And I found that it was really interesting that they actually had women that were in law enforcement back in the 1800s. Now, they were really matrons, so they just took care of women and children, and they did a lot of social work, which I find is quite interesting because a lot of what we do in law enforcement now is geared towards social work, which makes it really good that women were involved then and involved in law enforcement now. The Lewis and Clark expedition actually hired a woman to help go along with them to provide security for the women and children that were on the expedition, which I thought was quite fascinating. And then in the early 20th century, women started joining the police force. It wasn't until actually 1968 that they officially had women that got into patrol cars. And then the 70s and the 80s really made a big turn for women in law enforcement. And I can tell you from my personal experience, having a dad that was a police officer and a grandfather and a great-grandfather, and now my daughter is a police officer, which I'm very proud of. I think my dad was probably the first big proponent of women in law enforcement, but unbeknownst to him. If you would have asked him back in the 70s, he would have said, no, women have no place in law enforcement. My dad's Italian, 100%, very protective of women and his daughters, and And as a matter of fact, he didn't want me to become a police officer, and we'll talk about that a little bit. But in the 70s, he was a supervisor in the Baltimore Police Department, and he had a commander come to him and say, DePino, we're going to give you one of the first female officers. She's going to work in your squad. He said, you need people, so we're going to give you somebody. He goes, oh, my God, you can't give me a female officer. I don't have enough officers out there. I'm going to have to put somebody with her to protect her. He says, DePino, shut up. You're getting a female police officer. So a week later, my dad went and he knocked on the commander's door. He said, DePino, I told you, you're not getting rid of that female police officer. He goes, no, I came to ask for a whole squad of female police officers. He said, it's a true story. He said, they write better police reports, they communicate more effectively, they don't have to use force because they don't feel like they have to be tough guys, they communicate with people and they can arrest people without a big fight. He goes, I want a whole squad. So my dad actually became one of the first big proponents of women in law enforcement, and I'm proud of him for it. Little did he know, though, that a few years forward, he would have a daughter that who was so, I guess, I'd see my dad as my hero, and he is my hero. And I just, between the stories that he told and that my grandfather told, I wanted to be just like my dad. I wanted to do that. I wanted to go out and help people and protect people. And my dad had so many great stories. And so I wanted to become a police officer. And he says, I'm sorry, you can't be a police officer. I said, why? I want to be a police officer. He says, you'll never make it through the police academy. I said, what do you mean? I'm tough. I'm strong. He goes, no, I'm going to break both your legs before I ever let you become a police officer. You're not going into law enforcement. But, of course, I did. He just encouraged me to go to Baltimore County instead of the city because the benefits were better. And he was right. They really had good benefits. So I started my career in 1985 with the Baltimore County Police Department. And I graduated from the 69th Police Academy and went out into patrol. And I know I've got some fellow Marylanders here, so you know I went to Precinct 12, which is Dundalk, which is a nice blue-collar area of Dundalk, a good place to learn how to become a patrol officer. And I became a narcotics detective. And then my dad decided he was going to retire, and he was going to move to Ocean City, Maryland, which is a beach resort town. And he asked if I wanted to go with him because I had my daughter and my parents watched her while I was at work. And I said, absolutely, because I love the beach. I love my family. And being a good Italian woman, I lived only two blocks from my parents, you know, so they could shout out the window at me. Now, my sister, she was in big trouble. She lived a whole 2 miles away from us, so she was in trouble. So we moved to Ocean City in 1988, and the first year I was there, I started as an undercover police officer, and not just a regular undercover officer, but a deep undercover police officer, where only the chief and one other person knew what I was doing in the job. I worked as a waitress, a bartender, a limo driver, and arrested a lot of bad guys selling drugs in our community, but I tell you, it was a challenge. And then I came out after a year and started working my way through the ranks. I learned early on that going from Baltimore County, which was quite open to women in law enforcement, it was quite progressive, but moving to the Eastern Shore of Maryland, it was like moving down south, and they had a totally different philosophy about women, and they weren't a lot of them, and they weren't really highly regarded, and of course, I was not going to have any of that. So I started as a detective, and I saw that they were doing some things that were not necessarily the best way of doing things. So I went to the lieutenant and I said, hey, I think we should write these reports this way. It worked. I went to DEA school and he goes, DePino, get out of my office. We're not doing that. We've done it this way all the time. We're not doing your idea. Just go out there and keep working. So my partner was a guy that I knew from Baltimore County. And I said, hey, Tommy, don't you think it would be a good idea if we did reports this way? And he's like, yeah, that's how we used to do it. Yeah, that's a great idea. So why don't you go to the lieutenant and tell him? So he went to the lieutenant. And guess what the lieutenant said? Great idea. Oh, that's what we're doing that. We're implementing that. So I knew, and I really didn't care about credit. I knew now how to get things done is I'd always go to Tommy and I'd say, Tommy, why don't you tell the lieutenant this? Why don't you tell the lieutenant that? So we got things done that way. But I knew I wanted to get promoted. I just had high aspirations. I knew from early on that I had to be a higher rank than my dad because, see, my grandfather retired as a captain, and when he became a police officer, he told my dad he had to be a higher rank than him. Well, my dad retired as a major, so I knew I had to be higher than a major in the Baltimore Police Department, and that meant I had to be chief of police somewhere. So I had a lot of work ahead of me. So I'm like, I've got to get promoted. And of course, you know what I told my daughter when she became a police officer? I was like, you've got to be higher than the police chief. And she goes, how do I beat chief of police? I said, I don't know, director of Homeland Security, FBI director, or something like that. I said, get working, let's go. So I knew I wanted to get promoted as quickly as I could. So I worked narcotics. I decided it was probably better to go back out to patrol to make sure I got to, you know, some experience out in the patrol world in Ocean City and get some credibility with them. And I became a member of the SWAT team. I actually was the first female ever on a SWAT team in Ocean City. And I shot, and I'm not bragging, it's just the truth. I shot better than all the guys. And they got so mad because I was a good shot. I'm like, I don't know, I can't tell you. My dad kind of taught me a little bit and over the years. So I was a good shot on the team. And I eventually became the commander of the team. And we had a great team. But I wanted to get promoted. So I studied really hard because I had taken a test before in Baltimore County. And you had to have a 70 to pass. And I didn't pick up a book. And guess what I scored? 69. Exactly. 69. And I kicked myself. I'm like, if I would have picked up one book and read one page, I would have gotten one more answer. But you know what? God puts us on a path where we're supposed to be. And I learned from that. And that was one of the lessons I've learned is you've got to apply yourself and take advantage of every opportunity and give 100% when you go to do it. So this time I was going to study hard and I was going to take that test. And so you had to have 2 years on the department before you could study and take the test for sergeant. So the test was announced and I had 1 year, 11 months, and 2 weeks. Now I'd had 3 years in Baltimore County, so I was like, you know what, maybe the chief will give me that 2 week extension. So I wrote up a nice memo to the chief. I said, chief, would you know, I've got 3 years in Baltimore County, almost 2 years. I'm only 2 weeks away from getting that 2 year. Will you allow me to do that? He sent me a real nice letter back. No. If I make an exception for you, I have to make an exception for everybody. Well, guess who that everybody included? Me. Nobody else but me. I was the only one that would have that rule applied to. I'm like, okay, I'm a rule follower, no problem. I'll wait till next year and I'll study next year. Next year comes, guess what they did? They changed the rules. They made it that you had to have 5 years before you could test for sergeant. But the guys that took the test the year before, they were grandfathered in. They could take the test again. I look back. Do I take it personally? No. I said, you know what? I'm just going to put my head down. I'm going to work hard. I'm going to wait for 5 years. As soon as I hit 5 years, they changed the rules again. They changed it that if you wanted to be a PFC, you could take it within 3 years, and sergeant was 5 years. So it changed the whole rules, and they actually changed the test also. I ended up not passing the test, and I knew the answers to the test, but I didn't pass because the way the questions were worded, there was no arguing or explaining how you got to the answer. For example, you had to read this book, The Principles of Police Supervision, and they asked, what are the 9 P's, the 9 P words of the principle of supervision? And I got 8 out of 9. I could not think of the 9th one. And remember, it's memorization. It's not like, it's a fill in the blank. So I'm like, I'm writing all these down. No points. I got no credit for that whatsoever. There was another question that I knew the answer to, and it had to do with blood alcohol. See, no, I remember every one of these questions. That's how it's still in my mind. They asked, what's the blood alcohol content to be illegal in the state of Maryland for a person under 18? And I knew what it was. It's 0.02, but technically it's 0.00 because you can't have any alcohol. But in order to get a conviction in court, and the judge will verify this, it has to show at least a 0.02 to be able to verify that it's illegal. And so I couldn't write that answer, and the right answer wasn't one of the ones, so I just guessed out of the four that didn't make any sense to me which one it was, and I got it wrong. And when I went in and explained to him, I was like, well, wait a minute, you get no credit. So they failed me on that test. I said, that's it. I am never going to let them ever not give me this opportunity again. So I went and took the PFC test, came out high on the test. I got promoted to PFC. And from that point forward, I studied so much. I took vacation time. The next time that the sergeant's test came out, guess what I came out? Number one, okay? I was not going to let them not promote me again. Thank you. Thanks. The most important lesson to share with you there is I didn't let it get me. I wasn't going to let them beat me. I took it as a challenge, as an opportunity. And so I became a sergeant. And then the next step was lieutenant. And 2 years later, I took the lieutenant's test. And I came out in the top on the list. I was off of number one by 0.02%, but there was two positions, so I got promoted to lieutenant. So I was the first woman sergeant, first woman lieutenant. And then our chief decided that he was going to retire. In 2001, I got to go to the FBI National Academy. In 2002, when I got back, he goes, I'm retiring, and a lieutenants and above are all going to have a chance to go for this new chief's position. So I was really the youngest, newest lieutenant in the department. So nobody gave me any second thought of being even potentially one of the persons that was going to get picked for this position. So nobody bothered me. All the rest of the guys that were putting their names in, they were stabbing each other, telling stories on each other, and doing. They didn't even think about me. And as a matter of fact, the chief came to me and says, hey, you know, it might be a good idea that if you, you know, kind of support this other guy for chief, maybe he'll make you a captain one day. And I'm like, okay, no, that's okay. And I put in for the job, and I ended up beating all of them. I beat all of them. I got the job. Thanks. It's a kind of a funny story. As one of the guys that was competing for the position with me, I was walking down the hall right before the interview process, and I'm like, hey, Bo, do you know what the dress code is for this? He goes, I'm not going to help you. I'm not telling you anything. I said, you know, I could be your chief next week. You might want to be nice to me. He goes, okay, this is what the dress code is. He told me the dress code. And then after I got it, he goes, I'm so glad I told you what the dress code was. I'm so glad that I told you. So, but he's a good friend of mine. He's actually a police chief in Iowa, and very supportive. And so there were challenges once I made that position, because I was not, the other captains that I beat were not too happy that I got the position. And being the youngest and newest lieutenant, there were some people that were not real happy. But I was very fortunate. I was able to select some good people that worked with me, and just kept my head down. And one of the nice ladies that I met here asked me, what advice would you give to some young girls? And this is advice that I give to women and that I speak to and to groups. And the biggest lesson that I've learned is that you can't listen to compliments or insults too much. When you listen to compliments or insults too much, you take your eye off the ball and you're going to get hit with the ball, because you got to stay focused. And that's what I've done my whole career, is I stayed focused. I'm constantly looking at to where I want to get and what I want to get accomplished. And it's not that I don't listen to the detractors or the compliments. I appreciate the compliments so much. Keep them coming. I love them. I love to hear them. But I don't take them too serious, because I may think that I'm better than I actually am and not think that I can do better. So I appreciate the compliments, but I put them and say thank you. And I think we have to stay humble in our lives. And then the insults, I look at, if you take to heart every negative thing a person says, then you're only going to be focused on that, and you're never as bad as they say you are. And I'm not saying you don't self-evaluate, but you're never as bad as they say you are. And then you have to look at, why are they insulting you and why are they complimenting you? They all have something that they want. They want to get something from you by saying something nice, or they want to bring you down by saying something that's not so nice. So best lesson is, analyze what they say. Don't take it too much to heart. You got to grow a thick skin in this job, and stay focused on doing the right things. And that's what I do all the time. Everybody, I'm sure, has had challenges in their life. We all have, and everybody's got lists of lessons they've learned. But that's okay. You learn from them and you grow from those lessons, and that's what I've done. And I've been very blessed. I was blessed to get the job as the chief in Ocean City, Maryland, and spent 10 years as the chief there, and we got a lot accomplished, and I built a great team, I think, and left behind a legacy. As a matter of fact, a lot of those people were still in those positions as of this year, and now some of them are starting to retire. And I was blessed to get the job here in the city of Sarasota. And I'll tell you a little bit about that transition. When I was ready to retire from Ocean City, I wasn't sure what I was going to do. I had an opportunity to teach in Italy for a year, which I thought would be really cool. Good food, cute Italian guys. I mean, I could travel all over Europe. This is perfect. I could teach leadership, because I actually helped a group of women, and I helped develop a Women's Leadership Institute for the International Association of Chiefs of Police. One of the things I think I'm the most proud of because being a woman in law enforcement, there's not a whole lot of women in law enforcement, and we constantly forget about the people behind us, and because you're kind of trying to get to the top, trying to break that glass ceiling, and you hit your head so hard, you forget, hey, it's important to turn around and help other women in your occupation. And it really was when my daughter became a police officer that I realized how important that was, that women look around and they help other women and support them. Because men learned that a long time ago. You know, they're out on the football field and they're hitting each other really hard and trying to win the game, and they're competitive, and then they're having a beer and smoking cigars together after the game. So they talk to each other and mentor each other, and sometimes women don't do that. And a lot of times it's because they're fighting over men, and I don't know why. There's plenty of men out there, so we've got to realize we have to help other women. And it was through my daughter that I realized we have to develop this women's thank you. This women's leadership class. One of the things we teach the women is, you know, to get promoted, a lot of times women think that there's 8 boxes, you have to check off all 8 boxes before you get promoted. Whereas men are like, I got 2 of the boxes checked off, I'm just gonna go for it, maybe I'll get promoted. So we have to encourage women to take advantage of opportunities. Even if you fail the test, you learn something from every time you take that test. So it's really important that we help support other women, encourage more women to get involved in law enforcement, because women bring a different perspective. Even as a chief, I brought a different perspective than my former chief. He was very much so, he had all of his captains fighting with each other. And that was good, because they weren't coming after him when they were fighting each other. And I understand this philosophy, but I was of the philosophy of, we're all on the same team, we all have to work together, and we all wear the same patch on our sleeves, so let's support each other. And it made things so much better in our organization. People trusted each other more, we were able to get things so many more things accomplished. I think the last thing I just want to share with you is that I realized that in law enforcement, even though I love my job as a crime fighter, that's why I chose this job. I like to catch the bad guys, and you go fast, and you know do all these exciting things. And I've done a lot of very exciting things in my career. Helped, but on a team that helped to catch an America's Most Wanted person, met John Walsh, all that kind of stuff. But I really found that the quality of life issues in law enforcement are really the ones that we in law enforcement have to focus on, because that's what people really care about, more so than catching the murderer or the rapist. I mean, people want us to catch them and prevent that, but really there's other things that are more important. And I learned that when I was the chief in Ocean City, when we were having a problem in our North Ocean City called Cane's Woods. And I got calls every day from people complaining about dogs and the owners of the dogs not picking up after their dogs. And I would get calls time and time again. And this one woman called me sometimes 3 and 4 times a day. You are the police chief in Ocean City. I pay your salary. You have to do something about these dogs doing their business on their properties. I want you to do something, chief. And I said, Mom, you have got to stop calling me. This is a true story. Mom, you have got to stop calling me over and over about dogs in North Ocean City. I said, I've got so many other problems to deal with. I said, you think this is a problem? Mom, do you have a prostitute walking in front of your street? She goes, no. I said, how about a drive-by shooting? Have you ever had a drive-by shooting in your house? She says, no. I said, robberies? No. I said, you live in a safe community, Mom. Just let it go. The next day I'm driving by, I told you I live 2 blocks from my parents, so I always drove by their house on the way home. And I was driving on the way home, and I saw this man with a huge dog on my mom's property doing its business. Now, my mom was an avid gardener, and I mean, had the most beautiful, beautiful garden, flowers. It was just lovely. And I saw her on her hands and knees planting flowers, picking weeds and everything. And I saw red when I saw this guy, because I knew he was destroying all that my mom had created on her property. And thank goodness I was in my uniform, because I think I would have gotten out and punched him, because I couldn't believe he was wrecking my mom's property. I was really surprised my dad wasn't already outside yelling at this guy. But it was right then and there, it snapped for me, that this actually is a law enforcement problem. Somebody could get hurt from this, because I was so mad I wanted to punch the guy. Imagine, and I'm trained to keep control, what a citizen would feel, especially when it's their property. So immediately I came up with a problem-solving solution, and it was actually quite simple. We put a trash can in the park. We put doggy bags in the park. We put some signs posted that, you know, zero tolerance, basically, is an ordinance. You can't let your dog go without picking it up. You have to carry a bag with you. And we knew every dog in our community, because they were all licensed. So we went and told and warned every single person, If you don't pick up after your dog, you're going to get a ticket. That's it. After we did that, nobody else, we had no other violations. Only one person got a ticket. Well, the guy that did his business on my mom's property, of course. My mom, I was a hero. My mom's like, you're the best police chief ever. You are the greatest cop. She was so happy. So it's a true story. a true story. So I love, if you can tell, I'm passionate and I love law enforcement. I love being a police officer. And I there's no other purposeful, a more honorable job that I think of that I'd be so happy after almost 33 years doing this job. I am as happy today in law enforcement as I was the day that I started. And even though, like I said, my dad wasn't real happy, he's really proud. And my grandfather's really proud, too. They both actually were there on the day that I was sworn in as police chief in Ocean City. And my grandfather elbowed my dad and said, son, she beat us both. So thank you all so much. I really appreciate it. Be safe. I hope you all got your get-out-of-jail-free card, because I handed them all out to all of you. You only get one. It's not transferable to your kids or anybody else. It's only for you. But my cell number is on here, and I give that to you because I do want to hear from you. I think it's important that you hear from the person at the top if you have any issues. Now, that doesn't mean that you call me if you have an emergency. You still call 911, okay? But if I can help, if you're frustrated and you want to compliment or you have something that's going on in our police department you want me to know about, you can email or call me. I'd be honored. And thank you again so much, and thank you to the organization. I appreciate it.
Hello, I'm Carol Hartz from the League of Women Voters of Sarasota County, and I'm going to just offer some short closing remarks. First, I'd like to offer an interesting fact. Alice Wells, according to Google, was the first American-born female police officer in the United States. She was hired in 1910 in Los Angeles. She was married and a mother of two. She was unable to vote because she was a woman. Second, I'd like to thank the organizations and volunteers who made this event happen. It was terrific. And finally, this is the 98th celebration of women getting the right to vote. Plan to join us again for the 99th celebration this time next year and the 100th gigantic celebration in 2020. And please remember, your vote is your voice. Vote.